glory to Jesus Christ. Mystics like Pierre de Desjardins, Western Roman Catholic, believed that the luminous heart of Christ is the center of the cosmos. And we Orthodox agree, of course. Professor Jaroslav Pelikan said that the problem with modern theology and with the church is that it has lost sight of the cosmic Christ. True Christianity always rests in the revelation that Christ is forever and all-encompassing. The reason we may have forgotten him, I believe, is encapsulated in this comment by St. Seraphim of Sarov, in quotes, "The other person is my joy." We do not see the other person. We do not see each other. And so we do not see Christ. If we looked deeply with mindful awareness, we would see that Christ is the one who stares back at us through the eyes of our neighbors. We also don't look deeply at nature, for if we did, we would also see God staring back at us. One of the most memorable moments of my life was on the beach in El Salvador, late at night with Jared, who's not here today, who had joined us that year on a mission trip. The sky was so utterly brilliant with gigantic stars hanging so low, it seemed that you could pluck them from the sky like clusters of grapes. The only sound was the gentle roll of the waves. Oh, there's Jared. Gentle roll of the waves. The only artificial light was a single street lamp way down the beach. And on the boats, we could see on the horizon, far out at sea. The only appropriate response to such astounding beauty was to stare wide-eyed in silence and amazement. No words were even possible. It would have been a sacrilege to allow even a single thought to disrupt this divine moment. That was pure, unadulterated church. It was clear that we were observing and participating in the eternal cosmic liturgy. And the presence of God in that moment was stronger than I had ever felt it up to that time. But we are too distracted and too busy to look and to see. And usually, instead of looking into this moment in which we live, we are lost in our minds somewhere else entirely. We are either stuck in the misty fantasies of the past or in fearful fantasies of the future. And we are rarely present and rarely truly alive. We are sleepwalking and we miss God. Presence and awareness are everything. The gospel of the story of the woman with the issue of blood underscores this dramatically. Let me tell you how. Because of the law, the woman was imprisoned in her home for 12 years. If she had a family, she could not touch them or be touched by them or cook for them or sleep near them. She could not leave her house. As I see it, she suffered from at least three traumas: the trauma of her disease, the trauma of the law, and the trauma of her feelings of worthlessness. The disease was horrifying. It destroyed any possibility of life she might deem valuable. The law defined her as unclean, and she became identified in her own mind and that of society as unclean. She was trapped in shame and fear. Shame is an emotion linked to the past, and fear is an emotion linked to the future. As St. Paul tells us, the law is a curse. And far too often we bow to it, even as it humiliates and mutilates human life. On top of this was the inevitable suffering of shame and guilt and the feeling of worthlessness. She had no choice but to surrender to trauma as her life. Freedom from suffering seemed completely out of reach until God strolled by. John Paul Sartre put it well, quote, "People often prefer a limited punishing regime rather than face the anxiety of freedom." The woman had a choice. Whether to remain in that limited punishing regime or risk a mad dash for freedom. But something happened. A door opened. Jesus came to town, and all of a sudden, there was an alternative. There was an alternative to living in shame and fear. The past and the future. And she decided courageously to take it. He who is the embodiment of the eternal present was passing through. And no matter how difficult, she was determined to see him. At that moment, she became present. At that moment, her healing began. As long as we resist the present, we will suffer a disconnect from the natural and life-giving flow, which is the Holy Trinity. "I perceive," Christ said, "that power has flowed from me." His power surged through him and into her. Her disease was healed, and she discovered a way of life we call faith, which is live in the present moment, non-resistant and non-clinging to past or future, and find freedom, for God is there. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And where is the Spirit? Always here and always now. To become fully present is to be with God and to touch eternity. The life of faith always invites us into the eternal present. Faith is not something that we have. It is something that we do. Not principles and doctrines, but luminous actions. And all luminous action is mindful moment by moment action. Remember, there are no enlightened people. There are only enlightened actions. This means that enlightenment rests on living luminously, moment by moment, second by second. And if we are not sure what to do, then there is a faithful response to that as well. We wait, unmoving, until the right action rises by itself. In the example of the gospel, it is until we hear the Lord passing by. As we begin to live fully in the present, filling each moment with faith and love, we will begin spontaneously to shine like the stars in heaven, like the stars that danced before us in the midnight skies of El Salvador. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.